Hello, Bee here, and welcome back to biology. As we start our lesson today, I want you to think back to a time when you were much younger, maybe even as young as you can remember. If someone had asked you to list everything in your home that was alive, you almost certainly would have listed any members of your family, parents, siblings, other relatives, and if you had a pet, you probably would have listed them as well. Would you have known to list any house plants that happened to be sitting around? What about plants outside in a garden or flower bed, or even the grass in your lawn? There's a good chance your 3-year-old brain would have missed those. Plants sometimes get overlooked as being alive simply because they don't move around and interact with the world the way animals do. But if we were to look back to our list of requirements for life, they must be made of cells, grow and reproduce, adapt and evolve, metabolize nutrients, and so on, plants definitely meet all of them. This is why they have an entire kingdom in domain Eukarya. Which kingdom do you think dominates life on Earth? We'll explore this more in the lesson PDF. We'll see as we go through our lesson today that plants have complex structures with multiple cell types and tissues. So, definitely alive. Before we get started with today's lesson, let's look at our goals. By the end, you'll be able to describe the main parts of a plant, give examples of specific cell types in plants, explain how cones and flowers are involved in plant reproduction. When we studied cells a few units back, we looked at the difference between plant and animal cells. Do you remember any of the differences? Plant cells have a cell wall. Animal cells do not. Plant cells also have chloroplasts, while animal cells do not. Those are the most important differences. All plants are multicellular eukaryotes, and their cells have a cell wall made of cellulose and contain chloroplasts. Do you know what a tissue is? No, not that kind of tissue. In biology, tissues are groups of similar cells that work together. For example, humans have muscle tissue, skin tissue, as well as others that you'll learn in a later unit. Plants have different types of tissue as well. The dermal tissue of plants make up their outer covering. It includes a waxy cuticle that helps protect the plant against water loss. Vascular tissue makes up the transport system in plants and includes xylem cells and phloem cells. Xylem cells transport water from the roots, while phloem cells transport organic nutrients to all parts of the plant. All of the other types of tissue in a plant are classified as ground tissue. It includes parenchyma cells that do photosynthesis and have chloroplasts. Collenchyma cells that provide strength and flexibility as well as store nutrients, and sclerenchyma cells, which are usually dead, inactive cells, but which still provide a rigid layer of support for the trunk or stem. Each of these types of tissue work together to create the parts of the plant, which you are probably already familiar with. Just as your arms and legs contain a variety of tissue types, muscle, skin, and so on, plant parts contain a variety of tissue type as well. Let's start at the bottom of the plant, with the roots. This is where water and minerals are absorbed from the soil. The roots also serve to anchor the plant to the ground. Plant roots can extend several feet underground and often spread out to a radius that is many times larger than the plant itself. Some large tree roots can even be visible above ground. The stem, or trunk, is the plant's support system, and the vascular tissue transports water and nutrients through here. Have you ever wondered how really tall trees, like the giant sequoias, get water all the way to the top? It's not too different from the way you may drink your favorite soda through a straw. Sucking on the straw creates a negative pressure in the top of the straw, just like water evaporating from the leaves at the top of the tree creates a negative pressure in the xylem tubes. The atmospheric pressure pushing down on the liquid outside pushes it right up the xylem tubes, just like soda is pushed up through your straw. The leaves of the plant are where photosynthesis takes place, so many of the cells making up the leaves will be parenchyma cells filled with chloroplasts. Some leaf cells may contain up to 100 chloroplasts. Remember that to do photosynthesis, plants need both water and carbon dioxide. The water has been transported up from the roots in the process we just saw. Where does the carbon dioxide come from? It comes from the air and enters through the leaves. But if the leaves open up pores to let in carbon dioxide, can't water evaporate and escape through those pores as well? It definitely can and does. The loss of water through pores in the leaves is called transpiration. It's not entirely a bad thing because, as we saw, it drives the process that allows water to be pulled up the stem in the first place. But the plant does have to be able to control it, especially when water is scarce. This process is controlled through tiny openings in the leaves called stomata. When water is plentiful and the plant wants to let in carbon dioxide for photosynthesis to happen, it opens the stomata. When water becomes more scarce, the plant can close the stomata to prevent transpiration, though in doing so, it may hamper its ability to do photosynthesis. As always, life is about trade-offs. In addition to the parts we've talked about, seed plants, gymnosperms, and angiosperms also have cones or flowers and fruit. These structures are involved in the plant's reproduction. We'll take a closer look at this process in a few minutes. How tall are you? Do you think you will get any taller before you're done growing? There's a good chance you will, but probably not too much taller. Most humans finish growing vertically around the age of 18 and usually end up being somewhere between 5 and 7 feet tall, then live the rest of their lives at that same height. Many plant species, on the other hand, have indeterminate growth, which means they continue getting taller until they die. As long as conditions are favorable, they will continue adding a little more height year after year. We know from earlier in the lesson that some plant species only live for a year, but others, such as the great basin bristlecone pine, Pinus longiva, can live to be thousands of years old. Imagine all of the history these trees have lived through. But at some point, all plants will die, so it's important that they are able to reproduce to keep the species from going extinct. Seedless plants, such as mosses and ferns, reproduce by releasing spores, similar to the way that fungi reproduce. The gamete cells from the adult plant are released directly into the air or water with no protection. But gymnosperms and angiosperms have evolved to create seeds. The production of seeds is a useful adaptation because the process encloses the genetic material in a hard structure that can withstand the elements until the timing and conditions are just right for the seed to begin growing. This is why seed plants have been so successful. The seeds of gymnosperms are held inside cones, while the seeds of angiosperms have an extra layer of protection, the fruit. Have you ever eaten all the way through an apple to the core? You'll find the seeds there. What advantage do you think it gives the plant to surround its seeds in such a tasty treat? Well, by attracting animals to eat fruit, there's a good chance that the seeds will get dispersed, possibly a long distance. This helps the plant species spread out over a large area, and who knows where those seeds will end up. Unlike fungi, the gametes of plants are considered to be either male or female, and most plants have organs capable of producing each type of gamete. This means that it is possible for plants to self-pollinate, as you may remember from Mendel's experiments with his pea plants. So both gametes that fused to form the seeds could come from the same parent plant. But plants are adapted to prefer cross-pollination with other plants, as this helps introduce more variety into the population and species. Pollen from one plant can be transferred, often by insects, to a different plant for fertilization. You'll learn more about how reproduction works in gymnosperms and angiosperms in the lesson PDF, so be sure to check it out before you take the lesson assessment. As we went through the lesson today, we looked at the structure of plants and saw how different types of cells can form tissues capable of carrying out specific functions that keep the plant alive. We also began to look at how plants reproduce, and you'll continue with a more in-depth look at plant reproduction in the lesson PDF. Next time, we'll wrap up our unit on biodiversity with an introduction to animals, which you'll later spend a whole unit learning about. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science. It's the way of life. See you next time. Hey.